Let's close our eyes for prayer. Our Father, we thank you very much for granting us journey mercies to be here tonight at the beginning of this Congress. We thank you for all the delegates who are brought from many countries in Africa and beyond Africa, and from all the states in Nigeria here. We are praying, O Lord, as we gather together, you bless every one of us in Jesus' name. We pray that from tonight, you begin to reveal yourself to every heart. Reveal yourself to us in your word. Reveal yourself to us in a time of prayer. And we pray, O Lord, that you'll grant us a vision from heaven. And that vision from heaven, your spirit will paint a perfect picture before us. Show us what to do. Show us what is ahead of us. And show us the grace and the power to be able to do what you want us to do in Jesus' name. Glorify yourself in every life. Make use of everyone present here tonight and all the people that will hear this message in the cassette. We are praying, O Lord, that you'll use us in this generation, that in the closing hours of this age, you raise up an army that will move on and take the countries and the continents for you. Thank you, Lord, because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name, we pray. I welcome every one of you formally to the Congress of this year in Jesus' name. As you would have felt in your own heart, and as you have related with other people, you must have sensed how special the Congress of this year is. And we praise the name of the Lord because he has granted you the chance, the opportunity, the interest, the love, the desire to be here, and here you are. And your coming here will not be in vain in Jesus' name. We're starting with the message, vision and mission for a new millennium. Vision and mission for a new millennium. In Proverbs chapter 29, reading from verse 18. Where there is no vision, the people perish. But he that keepeth the law, happy is he. Where there is no vision, the people perish. Talking in the physical and the natural, you need your eyes, and you need those clear eyes to be able to see. And what you see determines the direction in which you move, the direction in which you go. Ellen Keller, a woman, was born blind. And then the question was posed to her. And the question is, Ellen Keller, what do you think is worse than being born blind? And she quickly replied, to have sight and to have no vision. There are many, many people that see in the physical and the natural, but they do not have any vision. They cannot see the vision of the Lord. And as we come into the dawn of the new millennium, and we face the new challenges of this decade and century, we need the vision. The new millennium introduces us to a new set of problems. There are many changes that are taking place already in our lives and our ministries. You will find out that one. And there are technological changes, and we already have complex communications. Already, the industrial revolution is giving way to information revolution. That's exactly what Daniel said, that in the latter times that knowledge will increase. In fact, the scientists tell us now that every 20 months that knowledge information doubles, which means the church is not seeing the challenges of the new age and the new time. We'll not be able to catch up with the times in which we live. In fact, knowledge has so increased, and those of us in education and technology will understand. Computers now take over what we used to do manually. In fact, manual typewriters are now obsolete. And very soon, personal computer will be handling most of the calculating jobs, and videos and computer courses will almost take over the traditional study methods. It's just showing you how things are changing. And yet, as these things are changing, there is something that we need. We need vision from the Lord. And good enough, the Lord himself has promised that in the last days, he'll pour his spirit upon all flesh. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 2, Reading there from verse 17, it says, "And it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh, and it says, your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams." It tells us the outpouring of the Spirit of God will also usher in young men, young women that will see the vision of the Lord. That's what we're talking about tonight. A vision is having a kind of foresight. You see into the future, and the Lord paints the picture before you there, that this is what ought to be done, and this is what will be done. And as you yield to that, and you cooperate with the Lord, and you have the grace and the power and the strength to do what He reveals, then you find He fulfills the vision by a mission, and the great works are done. The five C's you need to make the vision come to pass. Number one is clarity. What are you supposed to do? What are we called to do? It was very clear to Paul the apostle from the beginning what he was to do. And if the vision is going to make any meaning, number one, there will be clarity. Number two, there will be competence. We need some capacity, ability. We need intelligence. We need all that we can get to have so that we'll be able to carry out all that we need to do. That will necessitate developing ourselves to face the challenges of our time. Number three is concentration. The battle of the present time and the fulfillment of the vision is not for the person that is absent-minded, for the one that cannot concentrate on the things to be done. You need clarity of the vision, you need competence to carry out the vision, and you need concentration. Number four, you need creativity. Because doing things the old way will not always win the battle, will not always gain the day, will not always have the success. But creativity, always looking for ways to do what needs to be done in a better way than we did it before. Number five, there's going to be need for courage. Courage, because trying new things, going new ways, and accomplishing new things, and getting into places that you are not sure of because it's right in the future. But that is the thing that is actually going to help us to be able to accomplish what the Lord is setting before us. There are three points we're going to consider. Number one is the vision. Number two is the mission. Number three is the commission. Number one, vision for the new millennium. The vision for the new millennium. Number two, mission in the new millennium. That means you have something to do. You are not just occupying space. The Lord has painted the picture. There is something for you to carry out, and then you put your neck to the yoke, you address yourself to the work. There's a mission in the new millennium, and then commission in the new millennium. Number one, vision for the new millennium. Vision gives purpose to living, and it's vision that makes us have focus in our ministry. You know, if you don't have vision, every problem is a serious problem. But when you have a vision, when you have a goal, when you have a dream, when there's something that is kicking you from within, when there is a passionate desire, something that will not let you go, and you will not let it go, no problem is a problem. Because you wouldn't even see the problem at all. You see too much of the glory of God, and too much of what you are going to get, and too much of what you are going to accomplish, and therefore you do not see any problem at all. Let me illustrate it this way. It's like the 12 spies that went, and they went to see the land. And when they went to see the land, they all saw vision. I say vision because they saw something. And for the 10 of them, what they saw stopped there. They couldn't move on because they concentrated. They were obsessed with four G's. Number one, they saw giants there, and it was so big in their hearts. Number two, they saw great cities there. Number three, they saw graves there. In fact, they brought back the graves. Number four, they saw themselves as grasshoppers. And all they could see, opening their eyes, closing their eyes, thinking about it, meditating about it, the four G's became so big within them, they began to cry. They said, "We are not able." But you know, the other two spies, Caleb and Joshua, they saw the four G's all right, but then they saw another G. They saw the giants. They too, they saw the great cities. They too, they saw the graves. They too, they heard of the people talking about grasshoppers, but they were obsessed with another G, that is their God. They said, "Our God is with us." And when you see a picture from the Lord, and the picture of the Lord, and the picture of a big God, and a great God, and you are obsessed and possessed with the might of your God, all those other G's, they mean nothing to you at all. That's what is important as we come to this new millennium. And as we're looking at the future stretched out before us, and we're wondering, what will I do before you take a step? You need a vision from the Lord. And if you're going to get the vision, you'll get down on your knees in prayer. You say, "Lord, show it to me. Show it to me." Because it was when Abraham saw the vision, that's when everything turned around. It was when Joseph, when he saw the vision, he knew there is a future. It was when Moses, when he saw the invisible, what all the other people could not see, he knew there is a goal in life. It was when Elisha, when he saw the vision of the coming ministry, it was when he knew that there is something ahead. And Paul the apostle, he was going on the way to Damascus, and didn't a vision that he saw, didn't that change him? It was when he saw that vision that everything totally changed. Come back to that Proverbs again, chapter 29, verse 18. Where there is no vision, the people perish. Turn that around. Where there is a vision, the people come alive. They get saved. When there is a vision, when God gives somebody a vision of what Christ has done, a vision of what we can do through the power of the Lord, then you know that something great, something wonderful is about to be done. In fact, history is filled with examples of people that did great things when they saw the vision of the Lord, and when those visions, when they were kept alive. But when they lost the vision, then they lost the purpose for living. You might have read about Alexander the Great. He had a vision. His father had conquered a part of the world. And then his father said, "I'm sorry, my son. With all that I've done, I don't know whether there is anything left for you to do." But that Alexander the Great, he had a vision. He wanted to conquer the world. And before he was 30 years of age, that had been done. Unfortunately, when he lost the vision, he couldn't conquer the liquor bottle, and beer conquered him. But you see, in the Bible, Samson had a vision. As long as he had a vision, and the vision was still alive, he won many battles. When he lost the vision, Delilah defeated him. You remember David, when he had a vision of the Lord, and he saw his God, how great his God was. He said, "I come to you," talking to Goliath, "I come to you in the name of the Lord." He saw his God at that time. He had a vision at that time. When he lost the vision, he's lost, the lust of the flesh conquered him. You remember Peter, when he had a vision of the Lord, "I will follow you." And then he was following the Lord. They went to the Mount of Transfiguration, and when the vision was still alive, he thought he could take on anyone and he could do anything. When he lost the vision, he went back to his nets. It's very important for us to have a vision. And as the Lord gives the vision, we need to be able to understand the vision. In Isaiah chapter 29, Isaiah chapter 29, reading from verse 11. "And the vision of all is become unto you as the words of a book that is sealed, which men deliver to one that is learned, saying, 'Read this, I pray thee.' And he says, 'I cannot, for it is sealed.' And the book is delivered to him that is not learned, saying, 'Read this, I pray thee.' And he says, 'I am not learned.'" You understand then, vision. For you to be able to understand it and carry it out, you need some understanding. And the Lord needs to give you understanding on how it will be carried out. That's why Habakkuk said in Habakkuk chapter 2, Habakkuk chapter 2, reading there in verse 2. Habakkuk chapter 2, reading in verse 2. Here we hear the word of the Lord. It says, and the Lord answered, and the Lord answered me and said, write the vision and make it plain upon the tables, that he that readeth it, he may run that readeth it. Which means then, as you come here to the Congress and you're hearing message after message, and you see quite a lot of things, and we're praying together, the Lord himself will grant you a vision from heaven in Jesus' name. But then you need to do something about the vision. Let me give it to you this way, and I do it this way for you to be able to remember. Number one, examine the present life and ministry. As you come over here, you will take time, and there will be some inventory. You examine your life, you examine your ministry up to the present time. Number two, exchange earthly pursuits for the heavenly vision. That's the thing that made Paul to be different. He said, I was not disobedient unto the heavenly vision. Before that time, he had been having some earthly pursuits. And those earthly pursuits would have landed him nowhere, and he would have eventually even gone to hell. But then he said, something happened to me. He met me on the way. He gave me a vision. And on that day, I exchanged the earthly pursuits for the heavenly vision. Number three, expose yourself to committed, consistent ministry mentors. You know, there are some people who have been ahead of you. It may be a state overseer, it may be a national overseer, or it may be another Christian leader. You see that the vision the Lord is trying to show you, and what he wants you to do, they are already doing it, and by the grace of God, they are succeeding at it. You study them, you get near them, they become your mentors. You are studying the way they are achieving those things. Expose yourself to committed, consistent ministry mentors. Number four, express faith in the possibility of fulfilling the vision. Because you know, when the Lord gives you a vision, it will be something above you. It will be something beyond you. It will be something you had never tried, you had never done before. If you do not express faith in the possibility of fulfilling the vision, you'll not be able to do anything. You need faith to be able to stand on your two feet when the wind is blowing, to say, yes, it will still be done. Number five, expect opposition to your dream. Expect opposition to the vision, and determine to accomplish God's will in spite of problems. Show me anybody in the Bible that had a vision from the Lord. We're talking about Joseph, he had a dream. Didn't he have opposition to you? We're talking about Moses, he had a dream. Didn't the people think of even wanting to stone him? We think of Paul the apostle, he had a vision. Didn't he have difficulty? Therefore, expect opposition to your dream. Number six, exercise all your effort and energy toward the fulfilling of the dream and the vision. Because if it's a real vision from the Lord, 20% of your effort will not be able to carry it out. 50%, 80% will not be able to do it. But then exercise all your effort, all your energy, everything you've got within you, and go at it. Number seven, extract every positive principle that you can find out of life. You read about other people, and you are challenged by the things they did and by the things they said. I read a little bit about Winston Churchill. I'd heard about him before, but in this, at the end of the millennium, and you know, the articles have been written about Albert Einstein, about Winston Churchill, about many, many other people. And then there is something I picked up in all those people. They had a vision. They were not Christians. They had a goal. Although they were not Christians, they said, this will be done. Eventually, Winston Churchill, they called him to his alma mater, to the school where he passed out, and they collected all the students together. This was after the Second World War, and Winston Churchill had led Britain to be able to overcome. It was a difficult thing. Germany would have just wiped them out and walked over them, but because of Winston Churchill, he said never. And then they now called him back after the war, Second World War. They collected all the students together, and they wanted him to talk to the students, just to give them some courage and some push. And they introduced him. He's been out of this school, now he's come, he wants to encourage you. And then he stood up after they introduced him, and they welcomed him. And then he said, when do you give up when there is a battle to fight, a work to be done, in our own case, a ministry to be carried out. He said, never, never, never. About 3 minutes, he went to sit down. That was all his message. And all those students were expecting. He'll still say something else, but he never said any other thing, and it remained with them. And I bring that to you, that the Lord is showing you a vision. The Lord is giving you a goal. And when you have difficulties there, when you have problems there, when there is opposition there, and you are asking, how far can I go, holding on, persevering, putting my neck under the yoke, and just getting it done? When do I give up? Never, never, never. You will not give up in Jesus' name. Extract every positive principle that you can find out of life. We even extract principles from all those people who are not even Christians, because there are some good principles there. Number 8, exclude negative thinkers as close friends. Because you know, every time you say this will be done, then there is somebody that is telling you it cannot be done. It has never been done. You are just a dreaming. But you will exclude negative thinkers as close friends. When in unbelief, they write up every dream, every vision as impossible. Number 9, exceed normal expectations to make your dream come true. That means you are going to go beyond your normal strength. And then when you appear to be tired, you say, I'll do a little bit more. I'll go a little bit further. I'll expand myself a little bit more. You will exceed normal expectations to make your dream come true. Number 10 is to exhibit an attitude of confidence and faith in God's promises that cannot fail. He has given you the vision. He has told you what to do, and it appears the thing will not come true, and you keep on exhibiting an attitude of confidence and faith in God's promises, because God will never fail. Number 11 is to explore every possible avenue to reach your goal. You want to go from point A to point H, and you take this way and there is no way there. Then you turn back, take another way, and there is no way there. Then you take another way and there is no way. You keep on. We're told about Thomas Edison. All these bulbs you see here, it was Thomas Edison that invented the bulb. And he tried this filament, it didn't work. Tried this, didn't work. Tried this, didn't work. The people that have written about him, they said, some said he tried 2,000 times. Others said he tried about 3,000 times before he could invent the electric bulb. And then somebody came to Thomas Edison after, and he said, you failed 1,000 times. He thought he tried 1,000 times before he did it. You failed 1,000 times before you made the invention. He said, no, I didn't fail any time. Every failure was a step towards my goal. It was not failure. You tried something because of lack of experience. You failed. No, you are falling forward. You pick up yourself again. I'll try again. I said you'll try again. Therefore, you never give up. You keep on trying. You explore every possible avenue to reach your goal. Number 12 is to extend a helping hand to someone who has a similar vision, and you succeed together. You're not the only one that is going to succeed. Other people too around you, and they're Christians like you, and they want to have the work done as well. The Lord has given them a similar vision. You extend a helping hand to them so that you move on and you can succeed together. I go to point number 2. Now we've got a vision. A vision from the Lord. And as we get the vision from the Lord, we need to do something about that vision. Point number 2, mission, the mission in the new millennium. Having a vision is not enough. There must be a commitment to act on the vision. That commitment of acting on the vision is what is called mission. There is a set of specific definite steps that you are taking now to achieve the mission. A mission then is a vision acted upon. The vision is there, And then you say, I'm not just thinking about it. How many of you know, if we were in a class and I were to teach you how to swim, and I give you all the principles, and I give you all the strategy, and I give you all the formula, everything you are to do, and you are to swim, and then you write the notes, you review the notes, you do everything about the note, and then, but you never go to the riverside. You never plunge or dive into the river. You will not become a better swimmer. There is a time to learn. There is a time to get the vision. There is a time for mission. That is vision acted upon. You get out of your seat and you go to the place that the Lord is showing you, and then you say, it is time to act. And when you act, I believe that you will be able to, you'll succeed in Jesus' name. And that's the difference between dreamers and those who have a dream. There are thousands of dreamers. They just sit down there, they're daydreaming. I will do this, I can do this, I will achieve that. And they're just dreaming. But the people that have a dream, they don't talk much, but they act a lot. And they're able to rise up and carry out their life's mission. The mission of the church and the leadership in the new millennium is very clear as we look at the scriptures. Broadly said or stated, it is to fulfill the Great Commission. And in its specifics, number one, evangelize and equip evangelists. You want to evangelize because Jesus said, go into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature. And then also, you want to plant churches. Other sheep I have, not of this fold, them I must bring. There will be one fold, there will be one shepherd. He wants the churches to be planted, and he wants the pastors to be developed and to be trained. And then he wants us to teach and train Christian workers and Christian leaders. The things you have heard from me, among many other witnesses, you will give to other people that they will be able to teach others also. This vision we're talking about, when you really get at it and you begin to do it, let's learn from the life of Paul the Apostle. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 26, Acts of the Apostles chapter 26, verses 18, verses 19 and 20. Acts 26, 19, wherefore, O King Agrippa, I was not disobedient unto the heavenly vision, and showed, but showed forth unto them of Damascus and at Jerusalem and throughout all the coast of Judea, and then to the Gentiles, that they should repent and turn to God and do the works meet for repentance. As you pick up the life of Paul the Apostle, and then you see that everything he did before he got the vision, before he knew the Lord, it was like a big zero. But from the time he had that vision, number one, he was, number one, stopped by a vision. When he saw that vision, he stopped. He had to stop. He had the voice of the Lord. And when he had the voice of the Lord, he knew that this is a turning point. I'm telling you, the day you see that vision from the Lord, the day you get that vision from the Lord, it's the day you are stopped by that vision. It appears, you not look at your life, you stop. You say, if I continue like this, what will my life look like? What will I achieve? If things continue as they have been, what will be the sum total of my achievement and success at the end of the day? It is that thing that stops you. You are stopped by the vision. Number two, strengthened by the vision. When you have a vision, now you know God is thinking about you. Now you know God wants to use you. Now you know that you are not just to fill space here on earth. There is something to be done. This single life will be useful. There is an energy from within. And that's what he did to Paul the Apostle. Because in fact, God told Ananias, he said, he is a chosen vessel. Think of Almighty God talking about this man. He is a chosen vessel now. I will show him what he will do. That made him at Damascus there. He was strengthened and he began to preach. And then when they wanted to kill and destroy him, they took him with a basket and let him down. He went to another place preaching again. And when it appeared discouragement will come, the Lord showed him another vision again. And he saw the third heaven. And he saw paradise. And he saw things and heard things that other people had not heard. And when he got back from that vision, he was strengthened by the vision. That's why in the prison he was preaching. On the street, he was preaching. In the synagogue, he was preaching. Number one, stopped by a vision. Number two, strengthened by a vision. Number three, stretched by a vision. A vision stretches you. A vision makes you to feel, yes, there's something to do beyond my natural strength, beyond my natural ability, what I didn't think I could do. You are stretched. And Paul's vision stretched him. It helped him to become what he would never have become without it. As I was studying for myself, thinking of how life should be, I came across a story, a true story. This woman was 63 years of age, and the grandchild was playing with other children, and then a vehicle just came accidentally and ran over the leg of that child. And the grandmother was there, and the fellow driving was underage, and that fellow could not do anything about it, and there was no jack or anything to do. And that 63-year-old woman, he got to that vehicle, seeing his grandchild over there, pulled up the vehicle, and then removed the leg of the child. And after she did that, about five men, they came wanting to pull up the vehicle. They couldn't do it. She had strength. Looking at that child there, that's my grandchild, and this child will not die under this vehicle. I must do something. That's supernatural. A division was there. I can rescue the child. I can do something about it. And then she lifted up the child, and when she did that, this is even an unbeliever. And so the psychologists, they heard about that, and they said that we want to interview. She said, no, I'm sorry, I don't want any interview. Eventually, the fellow doing the research knocked at her door, and they came in and said, I'm so and so, I phoned you, I said I wanted to interview you. She said, but I told you I don't want any interview, but I'll make you a breakfast because you have come a long way. And while they were talking, that other fellow kept on asking this, asking that, and she was dodging, not wanting to answer. And eventually the man said, why don't you want to answer? And she said, I knew I couldn't do that thing. I felt I couldn't do that thing. I knew there was no way at the age of 63 that I could pull up a vehicle like that. But when that situation came, I got there. The strength I didn't know I had came, and then I did it. Then a thought came to my mind. Now, at that time, she was now 65. She said, all these years, were there things I could have done that I thought I couldn't do? And she said that thought had been haunting me, because if I discuss ordinarily, I would say I could not lift up that vehicle, but when the situation arose, I had to do it. It was done. And then I'm thinking, are there things I could have done I didn't do? And then the man said, tell me, what is it you have always wanted to do you couldn't do? And she said, I've always liked to study geology, but now I'm 65, my life is gone, and there's nothing I can do. And the man said, why don't you enroll at the university and study the geology? Oh, she said, that will take me 4 years. By the time I come out, I'll be 69. And the man replied that you'll be 69 if you don't go 69 without a degree. And if you go, you'll be 69 with a degree. And she thought, that's true. This is the dream of my life. This is the thing I've always wanted to do. She enrolled. At the end of 4 years, she graduated. And then she went further, took a second degree in geology. By the time they were making that write-up, and they were now telling other people, she was lecturing in geology at a university. Now, the things that you thought you couldn't do, you are stretched by a vision. Once there is a vision, once there is a goal, once there is a dream, and you are captured by that dream, number one, you are stopped by that vision. Number two, you are strengthened by that vision. Number three, you are stretched by that vision. Number four, you are satisfied by the vision. It's the vision that you have, and the thing that you carry out will actually make your life to be fulfilled. You suddenly realize, there is something I can do. I've been wasting time, and my time has been going, but maybe I'm 63 now, maybe I'm 65 now, maybe I'm 70 now. I still can do something if God is giving me the vision. That leads me to the third point, the commission in the new millennium. Now here we are. In the new millennium, the Lord is giving us a vision. And the Lord is telling us, you can do something. Pick up yourself and pick up your life and get something started that you have not done before. And let there be a commitment to the commission in the new millennium. You know what Jesus said? He said, behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you. Tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high. Then he said, you will preach the gospel of repentance in Jerusalem and then in all nations. And when he gave that great commission, he was expecting that his own people, they will take it as a burning issue as it was in the heart of Christ. And they too, Christian children of God, they will get that vision. And they'll be committed to that vision. They'll have the burning passion. They'll have the burning desire. They will say, yes, I know I can do something. I know I must do something. As you look at the Acts of the Apostles, you find a lot of times when the Lord showed a vision to some of his people. All those visions in the early church, they were related to the conversion of sinners or the strengthening of the church. And every significant vision today given by the Lord will have some bearing on the salvation of sinners and the strengthening of the church. I'm believing God and I'm praying to God, before you go, the Lord will show you the vision. He'll show you what you are created for. And the thing you are supposed to do. Maybe you think you are doing it already. And maybe you have not done 1% of what the Lord is calling you to do. You will rise up and you will do it. I said you will do it. What does it take if you are going to do it? When he shows you the vision, if you are going to look at it, face it, the challenge of the day, and focus your life on it, and forget the past. Number one, you forget the past. Number two, you face the challenge of the day, of the time, of the hour. Number three, you focus on the thing that you really ought to do, the Lord is calling you to do. What's he going to take? Number one, surrender everything to Christ. As the Lord is showing you the vision and saying, you can do something. You are created for a purpose. You are not just to pass through as a bird passes through the air, not making a mark. Make a mark on your generation. What's the first thing to do? Number one, surrender everything to Christ. Number two, sacrifice everything for the sinner's conversion. Don't let any sacrifice be too great, any price be too great that you cannot pay. Sacrifice everything to the sinner's conversion. Number three, shun everything that distracts from the commission. The commission is there. It's lying there before you. And then you want to shun everything because many, many things will call for your attention. Why don't you think about this? Why don't you think about this? Why don't you think about another thing? Be a man of one book, the Bible. A man of one goal. That is the goal, the vision the Lord has set for you. A man of one purpose, to rescue those sinners and to strengthen the church, training them when they come. Every other thing that will contradict or distract you from what the Lord has called you to, shun everything. Number four, study effective methods of better communication. In this new age, and in this information technology multiplying, you will need to develop yourself. You study effective methods of better communication. Number five is to stand firm on your commitment. Once you have made the commitment, I've opened my mouth unto the Lord, I cannot go back. You stand firm on your commitment. Number six, share the vision and mission with every congregation. You go to the congregation because this vision is above you, is beyond you. It's not a one-man business. It's not something you alone can carry out. You will share that vision and mission with every congregation you have opportunity to share with. Number seven, spend and be spent for the fulfillment of the Great Commission. Spend and be spent for the fulfillment of the Great Commission. The Lord has spoken to us tonight, and like Paul the Apostle, the time shall come in your life when you'll be able to tell King Agrippa or any other person that cares to listen, saying, I was not disobedient to the heavenly vision. I'm praying that tonight the Lord will give you an heavenly vision. And he'll give you the strength. He'll give you the power. Will give you his Holy Ghost, is a supernatural enablement. So that all the Lord shows you tonight and all throughout this Congress, you'll be able to carry out everything in Jesus' name. Do you want a vision from the Lord? I said, you want a vision from the Lord? You rise up and you will tell the Lord, I don't want my life just to be spent like that, nothing doing, just aimlessly going about. I want a vision from the Lord, and I want a mission in my life, and I want to be committed to the great commission, the thing the Lord has called me to. The Lord is calling you, my brother. The Lord is calling you, my sister. You can do something. There is something ahead of you. Therefore, you commit yourself to it. Commit yourself to it. When you have that vision, it will stop you. Stop by a mission. It will strengthen you. Strengthened by mission. And it will stretch you. You are stretched by that vision. And it's the only thing that will satisfy. You'll be satisfied with that mission. Whatever your age, whatever your location, whatever your country, you can do something for God. When the Lord shows you the vision, and he empowers you, enables you, fills you with his Holy Ghost, yes, you will. Yes, you will. The Lord will make use of you, lay his hand upon you.
Today, because God has been so faithful to me. I'm going to keep this very short. First of all, I want to thank God for the church. The church has been my family. Thank you so much, Pastor Dada. He has been a father to me. I don't start crying. Okay, I remember I came here without scholarship to Howard University. The first year wasn't easy, but I got a grant that paid half of my tuition. But then from second year, I got like 5 different scholarships from my classmates. And I thank God because I'll be graduating in May. I didn't have to stay out of the door. I just thank God for all his provision. I just bless the name of God.